A lot of channels have talked about the SIR model, including my own. But there is a very different way to model coronavirus, which boils down to how diseases really spread from person to person. This is generally known as branching process, because every individual here branches out to some random number of other individuals. Because this branching out is random, as it can have two branches, three branches, or even not branching out at all, we say this is a kind of stochastic process, stochastic being a fancier name for random. This video will focus on the simplest type of branching process known as Bienaymé-Galton-Watson process, BGW for short. So what does this BGW say about the spread of coronavirus? Before we move on, we need to introduce a few terminologies. All people on the same vertical line would be in the same generation. We call this orange column the first generation, with the number of individuals denoted as X1. Similarly, we denote X2, X3, and so on. Next up, we say these two individuals from the same branch, the offspring of the individual in the previous generation that spreads the disease to them. The reason we use these terms is that this process was originally studied in a different context related to reproduction, but that's a story for another time. Let's focus on the first branching here. We say that this is a random process, so actually it could stop branching right away, or branch to one individual, or two, or three, and so on. Because the number of branches is just X1, the number of offspring of this first patient, we say that X1 follows a distribution. The distribution can be more conveniently written as a table. The left column represents all the possible values of X1, and the right column represents the corresponding probability. So the probability of X1 being 0 is P0, and so on. Because these are the probabilities, they have to be non-negative, and the sum of these probabilities would be 1. The reason why this BGW process is the simplest branching process is that it assumes two things. Each branching that you see here are all the same, which means it all follows the same distribution as the first branching, so they are said to have the same offspring distribution. The second simplification is that it assumes each individual in the same generation spreads the disease independently. Independence has a specific meaning in probability theory summarized in this formula. As a very quick detour, let's see why we have this formula for independence. To see why this formula has anything to do with independence of two events, let's consider this rectangular box as the entire sample space. And the green and yellow ovals represent the events A and B respectively. Then the overlapping region represents A and B happening together. For the intuitive sense of independence, the probability of B should be the same regardless of whether A happens. So if we just focus on the event A, the proportion of the overlapping region should be the same as the proportion of the yellow bubble within the rectangular box itself. This means the ratio of probabilities on the left side equals the probability of B. Just by rearranging, we get this definition of independence. More generally, if we have n independent events, we will have the probabilities of them happening together to be just the product of the individual probabilities. Going back to the BGW model, the two questions that we want to ask is, what is the number of individuals in the nth generation? But because this is a random process, it can be 0, 1, and so on. So actually what we are looking for should be the distribution of xn, detailing the probabilities of the different values of xn. The second question is what's called the extinction probability. This is the probability that at some point, the entire generation of patients just stop spreading coronavirus entirely. But how do we get started on these two problems? The main issue here is that there seems to be a lot of parameters in this offspring distribution to characterize the entire process. These probabilities here can all change. So we want to turn this table to just one single thing. We do this via something called a generating function, which is a way to encode an infinite amount of data into just one thing. It does the encoding like this. The final product will be a function of a variable, say z. This will be a power series in z. The constant term would be p0, the coefficient of the z term would be p1, and so on. As a very simple example to illustrate why this is useful, suppose the probabilities are just negative powers of 2. Then using the formula for geometric series, we can obtain the generating function to be just a succinct formula. This hopefully explains why generating functions are actually very useful. Basically, if you have all these probabilities in the distribution, then you can encode it pretty easily to this generating function. What's not obvious is the decoding, but it can be done. If you are a bit concerned about the rigor of all these, pause and read this. Anyway, another useful way to see this generating function is that it is the weighted average of z to the power x1. This is because p0 of the time, x1 is 0, and so z to the x1 is just 1, and you get the constant term. And p1 of the time, x1 is 1, and so z to the x1 is just z, and you get the z term to have the weight p1, and so on. This weighted average is usually called the expected value, denoted as e of z to the x1. All these discussions would also be valid for a general xn, the number of individuals in the nth generation. Just that the probabilities, hence the generating function, or the weighted average are all different, which are all exactly what we are after. So basically, if we are given the offspring distribution, then we can encode it in the generating function, which can be written in terms of the weighted averages. Then we will find some way to find the generating function for xn, which we can then decode to find the distribution of xn, which is exactly what we want. This is a much easier approach than just directly going from the offspring distribution. In this BGW process, we have xn to be the number of individuals in the nth generation. Because the entire generation comes from the branchings of the previous generation, xn is the sum of the different copies of x1, because each branching is just a copy of x1. The number of copies is xn-1, the number of people in the previous generation. So the generating function for xn, written in terms of the weighted average, can be written in terms of this, by rewriting xn as the sum of copies of x1. This is pretty complicated because xn-1 is not a fixed value because it can vary. So let's suppose xn-1 is a fixed number m, and then we will see what we can do afterwards. Because we are calculating weighted averages, we have to sum up terms of this form, with the weight being the probability that the copies of x1 being a specific value. Because we have assumed all the spreading here is independent, we can apply this more general definition of independence. So we can change this weight into a product of probabilities as shown here. Similarly, we can rewrite the value here into a product of these powers. Rearranging, we get a product of terms of the form of weighted values. So if we first sum up all the values of A1, then only these two terms will be affected. Summing terms of this form is precisely the weighted average of z to the x1, which is the generating function for x1. Similarly, the same generating function appears for the other pairs. Since there are m pairs, on the condition that xn-1 is really m, the weighted average would be g of z to the m. However, xn-1 is really a variable. This temporary result only happens sometimes. More precisely, this g of z to the m will happen with exactly this probability. This is again in the form of weighted values. And so, this can be expressed as a weighted average of these powers of g of z. This is just the generating function for xn minus 1, but applied to g of z as an argument. In other words, gn of z is gn minus 1 applied to g of z. This is true for all n larger than 1, and so we can apply this identity again to get gn minus 2 of g of g of z. Repeatedly applying this, we get the generating function for xn is just the generating function for x1 iterated n times. This means that we have finally cracked the first question, because given the offspring distribution, we can theoretically work out the distribution of xn by decoding that generating function. As a sanity check that this is correct, let's suppose there will always be two branches, which means that the offspring distribution looks something like this, where the probability that x1 equals 2 is 1, and all the other probabilities are 0. This means the generating function is z squared. By iterating it n times, the generating function for the nth generation is z to the 2 to the n, meaning that the number of individuals in the nth generation is 2 to the n, which is what we expected. However, the second question will be discussed in another video, which will be released in a few days. What about limitations? Or the original context that prompted the three mathematicians to study this process? Don't worry, I will cover all these in the future. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to give it a like and subscribe to the channel with notifications on. See you next time!